I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Joann McFarlane and jazz. Check him out.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Programming is supported by UCare, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCare. Healthcare that starts with you.
I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting today from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. I'm pleased to have a great conversation with a friend and colleague, Jeffrey Hassan. He's leading the African American Leadership Forum. We're talking about a variety of projects, initiatives of the forum that focus on our need to develop access, resource, results for the Black community. I'm going to have join this conversation a new friend of mine, Denise Specht. She is the president of Education Minnesota. Jeffrey, let me start with you and give our listeners, our viewers, an overview of the work of the African American Leadership Forum.
All right. Thank you, Al, for the opportunity to be here. The African American Leadership Forum is a coalition, if you will, of both individuals and organizations that represent the African American community in the areas of business and philanthropy, education, health, economic development, and now public safety, which talks about police and community accountability. And we're a private nonprofit organization, and within the past year, what our primary effort has been is to develop what we're calling a united urban agenda, in which we bring together a broad cross-section of our organizations, not just ours. We're simply the convening entity. So McFarlane Media, for example, Minneapolis Urban League, St. Paul NAACP, North Point Health and Wellness, along with our Black elected officials, to have this conversation about what are the issues on which we can all agree. Historically, you know, we've tend to fractured and fragmented about those things that we can't agree on. We're going to leave those to the sideline, and people are going to keep doing their own individual things on those issues. But the issues that we can agree, for example, on education, we all agree that our children ought to be able to read at grade level by the third grade. We all agree that our children should be able to graduate from high school on time. We all agree that we should have access to quality health care, those kinds of things. And the number one issue this year, 2016, is to address the gross economic inequality that we have in Minnesota, highlighted by the recent publication of the 2014 U.S. Census data.
My sense is that the organization is a powerful idea. We've tried this in the community again and again over the years,
yes.
But it seems that this effort has particular traction. It seems that you've got a lot of great people coming to the table and staying. In fact, you recently announced a campaign that invites people who are participating to put money and to support the growth of this organization, you used a model that came out of the OIC movement, right. Reverend Leon Sullivan, where you ask people to pledge $10 a month, I think, for 30 months. Is that what it is?
36 months.
36 months.
Yeah.
And you've gotten a great positive response from the initial ask.
Yes.
So how do you see the timing and the potential for this to be a lasting system for our community, when we've tried it a bunch of times before?
Yeah. Absolutely. So I go back to the 1970s in terms of when I began my professional career. And at that point, I was on the Minneapolis Urban League, St. Paul Urban League, and even National Urban League all at the same time.
Boards.
The boards of directors of those organizations. And you're exactly right. We were talking about similar issues then. The big difference between then and now is that in the 1970s, we didn't have any black elected representatives, okay? We didn't have any black school superintendents. We didn't have, or had very few, black corporate and philanthropic representatives. And so we didn't have the power, influence, and the wherewithal to really command a lot of these issues. So flash forward now 40 years, we have, as Steve Belton said, I've heard that we have a black president. We in Minnesota certainly know that we have a African-American congressional representative. We have three state representatives, and on and on and on. Where we're now in a position to actually come together and influence each other. Now, you, Al, you've been in the community as long as I have. I often tell people you really need a PhD to navigate our community. And we can see some evidence of that with the recent demonstrations and protests that have gone on in which, you know, people are still attempting to fragment and fracture our community. Well, when I came into this position, because I've been here all my life, I was born on the north side, not too far from here, actually. I said, we need to reconnect as a leadership forum. We need to reconnect with our faith leaders, because historically, as long as I've been alive, they've been active leaders, and we all know that they led the civil rights movement of the 60s. We need to reconnect with our elected leaders. We need to reconnect with people in various positions of influence and authority in their respective areas. And I've been pleasantly surprised that we've gotten a really positive response to that. We started this effort of creating a United Urban Agenda last February. We held a series of three retreats. People stuck in there. We developed through consensus. If we couldn't achieve consensus on the issue, it fell off the table. So we achieved consensus around issues of education, economic development, health and wellness, and community and public safety.
Let me ask you for the bullet points on health and wellness, on economic development and public safety. I'm going to ask you last to talk about education, because I'm going to bring in Denise Specht to respond and to connect on the issue of what and how we pursue the interest of our community in the education arena. Mm-hmm. But, you know, what are the bullet points of your movement, of our movement, around health and economic development?
So in the area of health, the number one priority is developing and implementing an understanding of culturally sensitive, trauma-informed mental and behavioral health care. And I'm sure Denise can relate and understand this issue vis-a-vis education, in which we're seeing a lot of children coming into our schools who have been subjected to trauma, okay? And school officials and educators may not understand what they're actually seeing, okay? I was actually a child of trauma, and so when I see kids misbehaving, I understand what I'm seeing, okay? And so, and we know we have this egregious suspension gap between children, African-American children, and others. And the response, instead of really understanding and defining what's motivating the behavior, has been to be punitive, okay, Al, you've been acting up in class. Yeah. First, go sit in the corner. Mm-hmm. And if you keep acting up in the corner, we're going to send you down to the principal's office. Mm-hmm. Well, I used to sit in the coat room. I got sent out of class many times sitting in the coat room. Then they put me out in the hallway. But once they found out what was happening in my life, they, you know, began to understand that there was some trauma that was motivating that behavior. So culturally sensitive, trauma-informed care is the number one priority, then healthy living, healthy lifestyles, healthy eating in the area of education. Our big issue this year is around economic development, and we're asking state leaders in the public, private, and philanthropic sector to identify this gross economic disparity that we have as a number one priority in our community. I was talking to a group today and telling them, I don't know how many people, because of their age, remember the the loss of employment on the Iron Range back in the 1980s. Now, I happen to remember because my mother was from Hibbing, Minnesota. My grandfather worked in the iron ore mines in Hibbing, Minnesota. And so I had an understanding and connection. And what we saw in the 1980s, when unemployment occurred on the Iron Range with the mass layoffs, crime shot through the roof, domestic abuse shot through the roof, alcoholism, chemical dependency, all those things spike. Mm-hmm. Well, that's a permanent condition of African Americans in this country, right? Mm-hmm. And so those are issues that have been identified as priorities. And what we're asking for is simply that our workforce mm-hmm. and our contractors represent our be reflective of our representation in the population. So, for example, in Hennepin and Ramsey County, African Americans represent roughly 12% of the population. Mm-hmm. Then we would expect our workforce to represent 12% of the population. Mm-hmm. In the public schools of Brooklyn Center and Brooklyn Park and Minneapolis and St. Paul, for example, where 35 to 40% of the children are African American, we would expect that the workforce, whether it be teachers, social workers, principals, or you know, regular school employees, support employees, be reflective of the population that they're serving. And so those are our big initiatives in 2016, because if a family doesn't have stable employment, which has been an epidemic of our community for decades and indeed centuries now, then you're going to find all of these disparities that we're talking about. You're going to find increased domestic abuse, sexual abuse, chemical abuse. Matter of fact, all you have to do is go on some of our native reservations and you'll see that these conditions are just rampant because people don't have a stable economic base to support their family, send their kids to good schools and the like. So. And of course, you know, this is nothing new. We've been talking about these things for years now, decades now, but I'm optimistic that we can do something about it.
And so the barriers, I think, have been structural. I think the problem is that as often as not, when our community raises the issue, the thing settles out with blaming and saying that there's deficiency in us as individuals, deficiency in our culture, in our community. And that we are deficient as human beings as a consequence. Yeah. And at some point in time, I think we have to, and you were saying, I think, we can't accept that analysis and have to put forth a different story, a different narrative that validates and values our humanity and creates a demand for responsive, transparent, equitable, fair engagement at the table of power. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we now have the resources within our own community to address our own condition if given the opportunity, okay? For example, we know in the school systems where in the Minneapolis and St. Paul, 60 to 70% of the children are children of color, but 90% of the teachers are white, right? So, And my mother is white, so I'm certainly not knocking white folks. And we have some and many teachers who are actually culturally sensitive and understand, but then we also have a lot of people who come into our community that don't really understand our culture, okay, and want to be punitive when we express our culture. And we need to be able to balance that equation so our teachers and our support staff and our principals, administrators, reflect the children and value where our children are coming from. And then for our part as a community, we need to address, now we've been subjected to a lot of these things, and so we need to address the consequences of what we've been subjected to through some of these cultural sensitive informed care that we have the ability to administer. Just one of the things that comes to example is that we have Washburn Child Guidance that just built a beautiful facility over in North Minneapolis. Now, most of the kids that they're treating there are children of color, and the largest majority are African American, but they don't have any or have very few African American mental health and behavioral health professionals. Mm-hmm. That just doesn't make any sense. So we need to have our workforce be reflective of the population being served, and we have that expertise now. We may not have had it 40 years ago when I was just getting out of college and law school, but we have it now, and we need to be at the table to bring these solutions.
Denise, thank you for being here. How does this conversation play into your vision, your work, your responsibility as the leader of Minnesota's teachers through Education Minnesota?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me, and it's so nice to be here and be part of the conversation. So, you know, our organization represents educators and faculty and school support professionals all over the state. So I tend to bring the lens of a statewide perspective, but we also support and train and try to find solutions within communities all over the state. So many of the issues that Jeffrey has so eloquently described and spoken about are conversations that we're trying to have here, but also throughout the state. We're the voice of the professional educators throughout the state, but also we want to help be a voice for students.
Mm-hmm. Is there a tension between what Jeffrey has talked about in terms of having inclusion? Are people part of the profession and your position representing the profession in getting people of color diversity in the ranks?
Absolutely. About 2 years ago, we went throughout the state and had community conversations all over the place. And our topic was quality teaching and making sure that we have a workforce that's representative of our communities. And we asked communities all over, you know, what do you believe would help with this? What are you seeing? What are your values? What are you looking for in your school system? And as a result, we brought forward some recommendations, because I agree, we simply are not seeing enough people from our communities of color enter the education profession. And when they do, they're not staying. So we have to look at this in multiple ways, I believe. How do we recruit people to enter the education profession? And once they do, how do we support and mentor them so that they stay? Because we're finding that way too many educators are leaving way too early, and far too many educators of color are leaving the profession too early.
I'm Al McFarland. This is Conversations with Al McFarland. We're going to come back and talk more with Denise about some exciting, innovative strategies put forth by Education Minnesota. Continuing this conversation, Jeffrey Hassan, African American Leadership Forum, African American Leadership Forum. Thank you for being here. Thank you for what you do. And let's keep this conversation going. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you.
Stay tuned. I'm I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. Education, a big issue, and we're all looking for solutions. Denise, thank you for connecting with Jeffrey and I on the value proposition that you bring as the leader of Education Minnesota. But you've got some specific projects that I think and you think are quite exciting that we want to talk about today. First of all, give us some more background on the mission, the work, the vision of Education Minnesota.
So Education Minnesota represents professional educators throughout the state. We bring voice to our profession and we bring voice to our students. So basically, we work with educators and school districts throughout Minnesota to talk about what works best in our schools, how can we elevate the profession, but how can we get the best outcomes for our students.
And you partner with different school districts to make that happen.
Absolutely.
So let me introduce one of your team, Joann Campbell-Sudduth. She's the Education Minnesota retired school nurse, right? Who developed a program, and that program is having life now in your partnership with Brooklyn Center Schools.
Yes.
Let me introduce Patrice Howard, who's the coordinator or director of community schools and partnerships for Brooklyn Center Schools. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
Talk about what you've done to create a strategy that provides wraparound services for families and students.
Last year, I was introduced to full-service community schools by Education Minnesota staff, and I was working for 4 months on the project. I went to different agencies and communities like the Wilder Foundation, and we pulled together a group of individuals in St. Paul, Minneapolis, Duluth, and talk to them about the full-service community schools, our wraparound schools. And what those schools are schools that reach out to communities where there are kids who are not graduating at the rate that they should be. The full-service community school is a type of, it's a model, okay? And this model encompasses the entire community. And it's about bringing parents together with teachers and faculty, raising the graduation rates. And as a school nurse, I was able to give them an idea of what goes on in the school during the day. When a child comes in at 8:50 in the morning and falls asleep in class, what do we do? When a child walks around with a broken glass cut in her foot all day and nobody knows about it until it's time to go home, what do we do? So with the full service community school, these kids will be able to be treated in that school by a clinic professional. And you know, there are kids that suffer trauma over the weekend. They come to school and they can't function and they have behavior issues. So when this goes on, we're able to send these kids to the clinic where there's a mental health person that will do an assessment. And that way, that child stays in school, okay?
Let me ask you what, for instance, might be. I've had a couple of programs in the past few days that dealt with the trauma experienced by children on Plymouth Avenue. Mm-hmm. As you know,
yes.
The community is still reeling from and responding to the police shooting.
Yes.
And there was a 9 or 10 year old child that was a witness to that incident. I grieve as a parent and as a community member, as a television watcher watching the news, and I see this child who's witnessing the taking of a life. And I'm saying, what's going to happen with this kid? He goes to school the next day. His life has changed forever. What do we do? And you're addressing that, I think, but
yes.
So use that as a model for how we have an obligation and a capacity to reach and to create a healing experience for families and children.
In order for that child to be able to become a full citizen and become a part of a community, healthy, he has to be seen by a mental health person. And I know that people believe a lot in the fact that God will heal, but we're talking about in the right here and right now. That child needs to be taken through services, and it's gonna take a long time because it's about healing. That child has to be healed. He has to understand what happened. And he has to find ways to become whole. But he can't do it himself. So this is where the mental health people come in. And in any trauma, you have to have someone that knows how to deal with this child. Family has to be involved, community has to be involved. It's gonna take everybody to get this child back on the right road. And that's what those wraparound services do in the school. It doesn't stop in the community, it goes abroad. And everybody that can step in and help out, this child has a better chance of becoming a full citizen in a community, because he's gonna be giving back one of these days. Mm-hmm. And if we start now teaching him that what happened was not right, but the bottom line is we're human and we failed, but we have to move forward. We have to work together.
That's kind of the core idea of the full service community school, right?
Yes.
And in Brooklyn Center, you're one of, what, two in the state that have adopted this project mm-hmm. through Education Minnesota, is that correct?
Well,
or am I wrong? I mean, you're wrong.
Just a little bit. There's Brooklyn Center Community Schools is actually the first mm-hmm. full-service community school district, and we're still the only full-service community school district.
Okay.
There are other school districts that are participating at the level of the model. This model is set out by the Coalition for Community Schools, which is based in Washington, D.C. The second leader in community schools that I would say is Duluth. Mm-hmm. And they've been facilitating the model for a number of years as well. There are a few other school districts that are up and coming, such as Rochester, Northfield is in the works as well, and there's a few Minneapolis schools too, as well as St. Paul John A. Johnson.
So describe the model in practical experience terms of your district.
Oh, okay, thank you, because it's a very comprehensive model. In short, the school district or the school per se poses as the hub of the community. It's based on a needs assessment, so each site is different based on the needs of that particular community. So within our secondary school, Brooklyn Center Secondary, it's 6th through 12th grade. So the services there on site will look a little bit different from the services that we provide on site at our elementary school, Earl Brown. Our secondary school has been popular in the sense that we've been able to really kind of bridge and form these relationships with partners that have been able to support our young people with whatever needs are that has come about through a needs assessment. So, for instance, we knew in 2007 that there was a huge gap, a healthcare disparity gap in the Northwest area through a number of collaborative partners. Our Health Resource Center opened in 2011, and that's a collaboration between a number of agencies, Park Nicollet, United Way, the Family Partnership, several other organizations that are there and providing free and reduced cost medical services on site to young people 5 days a week. And it's not just our school district students, but it's also the Brooklyn Center community. They can access services too. And most times these services are free, and that's medical. We also have a volunteer optometrist that comes in, and so it's a story within itself. When the clinic came about, you know, our practitioners didn't see the need for vision. They just saw, it's just an additional service that's, you know, we can refer off-site. But then there became a barrier in actually accessing vision wear when the referral was made off-site. And so, long story short, we were able to connect with an optometrist who volunteers his time once a month. And every month, there's at least 20 young people that are receiving service and half are leaving with prescription glasses that we provide at no cost, because even if they do have insurance, again, there's a gap in actually filling that prescription, or you know, they may not even have the cost to actually pay the deductible in receiving those
glasses. And if they have the money, sometimes getting it done
exactly
is a problem.
Yes.
You know, so you're
yes.
able to bring all that service to
one site.
Completion at one site. You know, it reminds me, one of the people I interviewed a long time ago who was just wonderful, he's a physician, in a town in Mississippi, I can't remember the town, maybe it was one of the most poor towns in the country, and the town had never had a black physician in that community, and he chose to move there from medical school in Chicago, and started seeing patients. And the first thing he started prescribing was food. Mm-hmm. The people in the community were suffering from malnutrition. Mm-hmm. And so lots of times it's the obvious that we overlook. Mm-hmm. And what I hear you saying and producing is a chance to look at the basics, mm-hmm. the obvious in a way that's holistic, that's complete, and that wraps around the whole human being, mm-hmm. recognizing that human being is part of a community and the community part of the human being as well. Does that make sense?
Right. It makes total sense. And actually, it goes above and beyond wraparound services mm-hmm. because of the civic engagement mm-hmm. piece and relying on the community for social responsibility.
So civic engagement, break it out for me.
Yep, just making sure that you know we have our community is truly invested and is supporting and committed to the community itself and really extending its expertise and services, resources, whatever that may be, just a bridge and lever and leveraging resources. There's no way that the school can do it alone. They shouldn't have to. There's a number of times where you hear people say, well, you know, why do you provide food or why are you providing medical access? That's it, access. Mm-hmm. So by having those things on site, it helps to better position that student for learning.
Denise, let me ask you, you know, from where I stand as a reporter, I listen to the neighborhood, the community, and as often as not, I hear parents and families in this neighborhood, other inner city neighborhoods, saying when they try to come to the school, they feel they're rejected or disrespected or talked down to. There's an arrogance that discourages them. And while there's a formal policy of openness and engagement, the reality from their perception is quite different. It sounds like this model has a very proactive and intentional concept for engagement, supporting it. That's got to be a pillar of what you're doing. But respond to that.
Absolutely.
Is my observation wrong, first of all? Have you heard that before?
I hear a lot of that, yes. I think what is so incredibly special about the full service community model is that it unites the community. It unites students, parents, community members, resources out in the community, and the school staff all together. And when you have that kind of community uniting around what's best for kids, we get the best outcomes. Mm-hmm. You know, we talk about gaps in educational outcomes all of the time. Test scores show it, graduation rates show it, behavioral referrals show it. This is a model that actually takes a look at other gaps outside of the school. Mm-hmm. Because there are healthcare gaps.
They're related.
There are employment gaps with the families we serve. So when we are able, like Patrice, is able to go out to her community, assess the needs, take a look at the students that go to the school, and then leverage people outside of the community as well as you know, the strengths that parents and students bring. Mm-hmm. When you leverage all of that and bring resources and opportunities into the school, uniquely fit for that school community, you get phenomenal outcomes. And Brooklyn Center is seeing that, Myers-Wilkins is seeing that in Duluth. We believe other schools should have that same opportunity, which is why in our report we are asking for the legislature mm-hmm. to increase their investment.
Right.
Because number one, there's a lot of money mm-hmm. left on the table to mm-hmm. invest, mm-hmm. but this is a program that works. Mm-hmm. And we know that there are school districts interested in it. Let's give them the tools that they need.
What are you looking for from the legislature? What do you need?
Well, in the last legislative session, they approved $250,000 over 2 years. So in total, $500,000. Mm-hmm. We believe that that probably will fund two school districts to get a Patrice into their school districts, to have that coordinator do the initial steps, mm-hmm. Do the assessments, find out what's happening in our communities, find out what the students need. So that's there. We know that there are many schools lined up that would like to access that money. That's not enough money for the school districts who want to do it now. They're ready. Mm-hmm. They have applications into the state. The state doesn't have enough money to fund them. So we would like to see a bigger investment, at least fund the schools that are ready. Mm-hmm. We shouldn't make kids wait. Mm-hmm. We shouldn't make communities wait any longer.
Okay. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guests include Denise Specht, who is the president of Education Minnesota, an organization that represents professional educators and students in Minnesota. Its members include teachers and education support professionals in the public school districts, faculty members, right, at the Minneapolis Community and Technical mm-hmm. Colleges, University of Minnesota campuses, statewide yes. education. Yes. And here with us, Joann Campbell-Sudduth, who is Education Minnesota retired school nurse, talking about this important initiative, the full service community schools, and from the Brooklyn Center Schools, Patrice Howard. She is the director of community schools and partnerships. I'm going to continue with this conversation in just a minute. Stay tuned. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. A great conversation on the topic of education solutions, strategies that include engagement, civic engagement, addressing health, mental health, addressing services that families need in order to make sure their students are successful, services that students need to be part of successful families, and I think it's a great idea. Pleased to have Denise Specht here. Denise, you're leader of the Education Minnesota organization. One of the things we didn't talk about yet was the Family Resource Center. What is that, and what's the mission, and how does that fit into what we're talking about here today?
So the Family Resource Center is actually part of the Brooklyn Center Community Schools full service community school model. So Patrice would be more ready to talk about that. Mm-hmm. But I think what it is an example of is how a full service community school not only provides supports and resources for the students, but also provides training and opportunities for their parents and the greater community overall. It's, you know, makes the school the hub for the community. So it's not just about learning from 7 to 3. Mm-hmm. It's a place for everyone to get support and the training that they need. And I think the Family Resource Center is a great example of that.
Well, before we go to that, Joann, what does that remind you of? So you and I can think back to what schools were when we were young.
Yes.
And I'm just thinking that, you know, I remember Mr. Stevenson, who lived about 4 blocks from where I lived. Mm-hmm. I remember Dr. Chapman was a physician. He was 2 doors down the street. I remember the guy across the street was both a pastor and a member of the National Guard. And there was a sense of community, and all of us were connected to the grade school I attended in Kansas City, Missouri. And so this conversation, in part, is reminding me, bringing back that memory of what a joyful experience I had as a child in education. So what goes through your mind as you see this idea being developed? What do you think?
You know, I feel the same way. I grew up in a small town in Texas in the 50s and 60s. And when someone brought to my attention the full service community schools, I said, you know what? We had that when I was growing up. I said, my mother and dad worked. So if we got sick, there was cousin Jay on the corner that would come pick us up from school and bring us to her house. Community involvement, community serving community. Everybody in the community pulled together. It was an all-black community. We had an all-black school, and everybody knew everybody. So this concept of full-service community schools is not new to me, because back in the day, if you want to go there, that's what it was all about. Mm-hmm. And as far as kids getting into trouble, you know, we knew better.
That's right.
Because the message got to mom and dad before we even got home, okay? So this model is exemplary. It's like the ones we grew up in, but it just has a new name.
So, but the challenge, though, is that in part there is this break in this parenting experience in the past in the current generation. I think this is true. I might not be right. You can correct me if I'm wrong. but younger moms, younger dads, people that aren't as trained in the art, the responsibility, the role of parenting. And so we talk about babies having babies as a problem that affects their ability to provide the training, nurturing for their children. But then I step back from that and I say, well, you know, yes, but 100 years ago, I think my grandmother probably had her first child at 13. And 100 years ago, and before that time, our people were being, my grandmother's mother was a product of breeding. Probably, yeah, was, and had her children at 11 and 12. And so the problem isn't only just the, I'm not sure where I'm going with this, but I'm just throwing it up for somebody to respond to. We've got some unique challenges, but what's beneath it is this capacity and resilience to emerge. That's where I'm going. I believe we can and will emerge. We simply need to make sure that we have the strength of conviction and the dedication, the power to keep moving, and to express a vision of what our community should be and work for it every day without fail, without relenting at all. What do you think?
You know what? I think that with the young parents that we have working in the schools, I was K through six, and it was amazing to see the young women. They're in their 30s now. Their kids are, you know, K through six. Parenting techniques are not there. So in a setting like that, it takes another group of people to come in and help them out. There's such things as foster grandparents that come to school and they help young women out. And do they have a parenting center?
In our family resource room, we have parent education programs.
Parent education. Yep. For these young women to come in and learn about being parents, about parenting. Because you know what? That's a lost art in a lot of our young families. And we, this generation, we're the ones that's gonna have to help them move forward. And it's the village effect. That's what it's all about. And I hate to say it, but it's happening more and more. Our kids are getting, having babies, our young girls are having babies. Despite all the education, it's still happening. But we still have to be there to give them a way out, to give them some hope, okay? That's who we are, that's what it's all about. And this full service community model is open to that community to help these things, help these young people out.
So, Patrice, what are you hearing? When you hear Joann and I have this conversation about how it used to be when we went to schools, what are you hearing in this conversation and how does that affect what you do every day in Brooklyn Center and working with families and children?
I think your points about your past experiences, I would say that's pretty valid, almost similar to what I had growing up as well, which is why I have such passion for this model. I can tell you that we have a number of resources for young teen parents. I can also tell you that the Brooklyn Center, teen pregnancy has declined as well as sexually transmitted infections. You can grab that data at the Hennepin County website. But it's happened because of the number of resources and partnerships that we've had on site, such as Hennepin County Public Health, a Better Together Hennepin program. We have a on-site child development center called Baby Steps, where our teen parents are on-site receiving their school day education, and their children are in a quality child care program. There's a sort of wraparound services there where we have on-site the Minnesota Visiting Nurses program that are meeting one-on-one guidance with young teen parents. We have partnerships with Catholic Charities and social workers from Hennepin County, and just making sure that the parents, teen parents, have what they need so that they can provide for their young children while in the home setting. And then we have a number of parent education programs. We have just kind of a care coordination system where everyone is checking on everyone's for the whole purpose of self-sufficiency. So it's definitely needed. We've seen success. Our teen parents are graduating. They're staying in school. They have access and they have what they need so that they can be true examples and true role models for their young kids.
Denise, I always raise the question about equity and presence when we talk with Jeff Hassan, the question of how do we get more black and people of color inside the organization, not only as teachers, but as administrators, as social workers, and as businesses who sell goods and services to the institutions of education. And to me, the idea is, again, reflecting back to the neighborhood I grew up in, where everybody there either worked or business or was a preacher, but they were connected and vested, not only through the desire to have a decent and quality and safe and successful education for their children, but they actually saw themselves as owners of the enterprise. I think that's been a challenge here, and part of it is external, part of it's internal. I think our people maybe have walked away, or if they were turned away, they stepped away and didn't come back, and therefore did not maintain the level of engagement that was required. But I think in many cases, they were inappropriately pushed back and not welcomed, and that has to change. But do you see what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
And how do we deal with that? How does your organization try to create a best practices system that is inviting and that encourages diversity?
Well, being part of this discussion and talking about this model is one of them.
Yes.
We also have to do a better job making sure that we talk about how, everybody together being part of the school community is how we find success. I'm an elementary teacher, second grade teacher. I can't do my work alone. Mm-hmm. And I think that what we're finding is more and more educators are really taking a look at the community as an asset. Mm-hmm. Parents are an asset. We're all on the same team. And when we're welcoming and inclusive and inviting people in to be part of the solutions, then we're going to have better outcomes for kids, which is what is so phenomenal about the full-service community schools model, because you have the people who are closest to the children making decisions and impacting the resources that are happening in the schools, the activities that are being provided. And then we get really good outcomes for kids. When decisions are made further away from the students, I think the worse outcomes we see. So as long as we can keep those ideas closest to kids, the better we're going to be.
Give me a description of some of the other Education Minnesota priorities. What other projects are you working on? This is a great one, and I thank you all for being here. Tell me what your portfolio includes.
Right. So coming into the next legislative session, we have a couple of things on our list, recognizing that it's a very short session, only 2 months. So we know the likelihood of having a lot of those things happen are probably not so good. But we are going to have this conversation. You know, the legislature left $1 billion on the table at the end of the last legislative session. The forecast is out today. My sense is there is more money that can be invested in our children. So we want to see an additional investment into this program. We are also talking about funding overall, making sure that our schools across the state are seeing a continued investment. They saw for about a decade disinvestment and starving of our schools. So they're trying to, make up for that. Another thing that we're talking about is making sure that we are investing in the teacher development and evaluation law that was passed a couple of years ago. For the first time ever, our state is having a conversation about how we can improve teaching and learning through having better professional development for the educators in the school, and making sure that I am getting good feedback and coaching to be the best teacher I can be. So those are a few of the things that we're talking about, but we're also adding to that, how do we recruit and retain a more diverse education workforce? We need people entering into the profession. There are a lot of shortages out there. So how can we get people to think about teaching, get into the profession, and how do we keep them once they're there? We need to provide support and mentoring and add other school staff into our schools so that people are getting the support that they need as well. We don't have enough counselors. We don't have enough school social workers. We don't have enough nurses. Our schools and our students need support professionals so that we can all do our work better.
You said before we went on, one of the ideas is that we should have a system that in Minnesota, your educational experience shouldn't be determined by your zip code. You didn't say it that way. You can say it the way you say it. That's the way I heard it. I agree with that. We have to have a system that is equitable, that's fair, and that advantages every resident of our state, every child, and helps him or her achieve, move towards the potential that they have. So explain what you mean when you say it. That's what I heard you say, and I agree with it. But go ahead, okay. Say it in your own words.
I just believe that every child, no matter where they live, deserves the best chance that they can have to be the best citizen that they can be. At Education Minnesota, we prepare students for successful lives, not just students in one city or in one neighborhood, all students. And when we take a look at all of the gaps, you know, we have achievement gaps, but we have gaps all over the place. And when we look at closing all of those gaps, we're going to have better outcomes for our students. There are so many things that are affecting the work that we do in our schools. And when we start looking at models like this, the full service community school model, that's one way that we can take a look at reducing all of the gaps so we can have better outcomes for our students.
Patrice, how does your model create opportunities for entrance into the education arena by our people, by black people, or people of color?
Yeah, I can speak a little bit to it. I can tell you that this year we, last school year, but we worked on a new strategic plan. So some of the priorities that the superintendent has is, you know, diversifying the workforce. So we're doing things like
from what to what? What's the current picture?
About 90% staff, white staff, and about maybe 10% staff of teaching staff of color. It's probably about a little bit 20-30 staff of color in general. But we are doing community conversations. We have a partnership with the University of Minnesota where their graduate program comes over a couple times a year and learns about the community school model and different resources and, you know, and exposing them early on. And but there's a number of things where we're engaging parents and you know, exposing them to volunteer opportunities first, and just inviting them in. You know, is this something that you want to be a part of? There's been a number of times where my colleague has invited a parent in, and then, you know, next thing you know, they're now employed with us because of their great experience. But we continue to do that. I can tell you specifically that our partnerships really do resemble the race and ethnicity of our students, and that's a concerted effort that we pretty much take pride in, and to make sure that our students, you know, are really can really have that level of comfort, you know, and confiding in an expert that, you know, can pretty much, you know, attest to some of the things that they are dealing with, you know, whether it's, you know, someone who or may be interested in experience. Like, we have a video production program where our partners are African, and we have a number of African, our population of African students at Brooklyn Center Schools is pretty large, and so students see themselves as being in the film industry, you know, because of that particular partnership.
Super.
So that's just something.
Listen, thanks. The hour goes so fast. Thanks. You all are wonderful, and thank you for the work that you do. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. I thank my guest, Joann Campbell-Sudduth, a nurse with Education Minnesota. She's retired, but a pillar in our community. Patrice Howard, the Director of Community Schools and Partnerships for Brooklyn Center Schools. Thank you, Patrice, for what you do and how you represent what you do. You've done a great job. And Denise Specht. Denise leads Education Minnesota. Great work. Keep it up. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Join us again next time. Bye-bye.
Programming is supported by UCARE, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCARE, healthcare that starts with you.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say good night. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning, right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Because this thing is safe. The message is clear. Everybody knows we got to keep it nice clear.